So I'm Adrian, I work on CAMO, and I'm going to talk a little bit about long-running stateful processes with CAMO. The agenda for today, I'm going to introduce CAMO a little bit, but not much, because the people before me did that very well, Christian and Kai. Then I'm going to talk a little bit about business processes. It's a very large topic. I assume many of you know about it, so I'm not going to go too much into it. Then I'm going to explain how far CAMO goes with supporting business processes. Then I'm going to touch on persistence and the pattern that applies to this, the claim check pattern, and then go to the demo and then a QA session. I would like to make it interactive as possible, so I'm going to try to engage you a little bit. I know that you're tired, but I don't want you to get sleepy. So I have a surprise for you at the end of the session. So I'm Adrian, I'm a commuter on a few Apache projects, including CAMO, ActiveMQ, Rave, recently Ode, which deals with business processes as well. And I'm a principal architect for Talend. So without further ado, I'm going to jump and talk a bit about CAMO. What's, I think, not emphasized enough about CAMO is its features. So CAMO provides two big things. One is the middleware abstraction API, which is a very simple API based on things, you know, message exchange, endpoint, producer, consumer, component, expressions, things like this, that is precisely the thing that allows many people to write their own components without really caring about how they're going to be used on one side. And it allows us to write EIPs without really caring what technology, what protocol is used underneath. So it's very basic separation of concerns. So that's the middleware abstraction API. And the second thing is the mediation framework based on the well-known enterprise integration patterns. I should have started with trying to poll the audience a little bit about how proficient you are with CAMO. How many people use CAMO here? Almost everybody, okay. And who's, say, intermediate or up? And who's beginner to intermediate? Okay, I assume the rest are gurus then. Okay. So my presentation, by the way, is going to be slightly different. I hope I'm going to show some significant code, but it's not really on the beaten path. It's probably not very much like the CAMO code you've seen before, so I want to show you new things you can do with it. I'm going to try to ask you now and then to see if you're still with me, okay? So I like talking about CAMO use cases a lot. Lightweight business processes is very popular. Then we use it as a value-added router, putting a proxy and doing some extra things in between, like validation maybe, or changing data formats, things like this. A topology adapter that's very useful when you have some tightly coupled systems. They talk, request, reply, peer-to-peer, web services kind of stuff that doesn't scale very well, right? So, I mean, you can put load balancers and stuff in between, but if you want to go asynchronous, what you can do is put a proxy that kind of mimics the end system near your client, put a stub near your server, and in between the two CAMO proxy and stub, you can talk asynchronously. Does that make any sense? Okay. Then protocol adapter, and the next one, it's web servicizing legacy apps. You can write a component that talks with your legacy application, but with a CAMO route, you expose that functionality via web service. Very powerful, non-intrusive, very simple. Test framework, this is really, really neat because when you integrate system, you have a larger project and you have to get data or push data to some systems that may not be yet available, or they may cost money, or they are built by other parts of the organization and they are not really ready, or they are buggy sometimes. You don't care. You write your own camel route, basically, that has a service that mocks the service you're replacing, and then you can use some mock data and just, you know, use that service for your other work and many other things. So that's about camel. So I'm gonna move to business processes. Again, I don't want to talk too much about camel because those before me did a fantastic job at that already. So this is the Wikipedia definition for a business process. There are many definitions, so I couldn't find anything that you know is better than that, but it's basically a collection of related activities, right? That's serve a particular goal. Open source projects that deal with business process in general are Apache Ode. It's a Beeple engine, pretty mature, not a lot of activity lately, but it's used by many, to my surprise. Then there is Bonita, JPPM, Activity, and well, Camel can help you too. By the way, the projects are in no particular order listed. There are others less popular. I think Activity is quite popular, and I saw it used a lot recently. There are also a few specs I'll talk about. So there are many ways to classify business processes, and there are PhD theses. A lot of people did research on that, and they classify them by all sorts of things, you know, the domain, reuse, who's maintaining them, all sorts of stuff. But what we care about, or what I care about today, is mostly the language and the duration. So by language, they try to standardize business processes. We have WS Beeple, and roughly at the same time, the choreography description language was done at W3C. A bit later, BPMN appeared. Conversational patterns are interesting. There were some talks about that, and even Greg Hope, I think Christian mentioned his book, Enterprise Integration Pattern. He planned to do a follow-up with a conversational pattern book, but that didn't come up. And then there are obviously flowcharts and other ways to describe business processes, right? So these are the languages. And by duration, we have the short running, the milliseconds to seconds processes, and that's Camel's sweet spot. Camel is stateless, right? So you have a message coming in, it takes a little bit to process that, the route ends, you're done, right? Milliseconds, maybe seconds at most. So that's it. And then you have the mid-running services. They could take from seconds to hours. You may or may not want persistence there, depending on the risks you're taking, how complicated the process is, what kind of function it serves, and all that. And then you have the long-running processes taking from hours to years. And somebody asked me what process takes years. Come on, ha ha ha. Well, paying my mortgage is going to take many years. However, and that's the funny thing, mid and long running processes are still bursts of short running processes with large periods of time when nothing happens, right? So, why do you need to persist? Well, you don't need to persist. I mean, if you have infinite memory and your system is 100% up, you don't care, right? So the only reason to persist is to save resources, because they cost money. And you could persist in, I don't know, Zookeeper clusters, depending on how long it's going to take. I mean, you know your business processes. And because there are so many variations, it's very hard to come up with one-size-fits-all solution. And that's, again, where Camel can help a lot. So, as I said, persistence may not be necessary for mid-running processes, but I'm not sure if that short thing, word, keyword there, clicking, because that's what makes Camel really applicable to this. If we can manage to use Camel for those short bursts, then we're in business, right? And I'll show today how. And since processing is triggered by events, right? Even those short bursts of processing I mentioned about, when do they start? Well, when some event comes. An example would be, who's gonna help me with some example? Man, it's a tough audience today. So, you send an email, you wait for the email that gives you some approval or who knows what it gives you, right? You don't know when it's gonna come in. It's asynchronous, it's depending on human behavior. You don't know, right? So the idea is that there are some events that trigger the system, and it's not only the initial event, which we're very used to, right? The one that starts the routing camel. There is the event that starts the process, but then there are the intermediate events that trigger the burst, right? And at some point, when there is nothing more to be done, the business process is over. So it looks like a long-running process could be modeled as a collection of correlated routes. Why a collection of routes? Because a route has one from, one endpoint, and we have all these bursts that start with an event, right? So that the event would be the start of a route. So it kind of looks pretty much like every burst can be processed in a route, and the only thing you need now is a way to know that actually all these things belong to the same business process, right? So what you need for that is a correlation ID. So what's this similar to the claim check pattern, right? When you have one message coming in, it's like the analogy for the pattern is the way we check in baggages at the kiosk when we fly, right? When we check in with the airline. So basically the whole thing, us with the bags, we go in there and then we are separated using some sort of algorithm, and the bags go one way, we go another way, so there are two pipelines going on in parallel, but at some point you have to bring them back together, which sounds like a what in camel?
Aggregator.
Yeah, it's an aggregation strategy. Hiram is cheating. So at the checkout, the message is reconstructing from parts, and then from there on we have one message that it's normal processing. So my slides are considered very dry in general, and these are dry as well, and I don't mean in the don't repeat yourself sense. But this is the claim check pattern as described in the Greg book and also on the camel site. On the camel site, we use the same icons from the book site. So we see the message coming in, the check luggage, the data enricher. We see the message going in the data store, and then the message with the claim check, but without the baggage, the big brown orange thingy gets processed, and at the end you have the data enricher that puts them back together, and then we're done. So in Java, there is exactly one piece of code in camel. It's a claim check test or something like that that deals with claim check. There's no other test in camel that does that, and this code comes from that unit test. And it reflects exactly what you saw before. It's from direct start, some endpoint. You have a bin that checks the luggage, then some processing, mock test checkpoint in this case, and then the enricher, and then we're done. So we're gonna see how these things are implemented, the check luggage bin. It's a data store put. Then we set the header for the claim check, which is the correlation ID. We use the customer ID, which is passed as an argument. It's actually a header from the message, and then we set the body to null. We don't need the body anymore. And then the data enricher does kind of the opposite thing. So, do you understand how it works? Easy? It's important to move on. No, okay. Well, that's one way of doing it. I don't particularly like it, because at check-in we would need a pluggable correlation ID generator, right? I don't want to take something from the message necessarily. I want to use something that would provide it for me, which could or could not be based on the content, right? And that sounds like a nobody? Okay. An expression. We need separate processing pipelines as routes, which the claim check pattern, the way we implement it, doesn't use. It uses just a data store, and it assumes that the data store is used, the same data store is used both at origin and destination, right? And then we need some pluggable logic for splitting the content, which there was done in the code. It wasn't too bad, but I would like to plug in some sort of something that sounds in CAML like a... Come on, please. The more atomic thing. Column-based router is a... But that's a processor, too. I was very frustrated that there was no coffee before I came in here, too. And there is another thing we need, which is a time to leave, right? So we check in the baggages, and then something happens. Are they going to stay in the system forever? And that was a check-in, but a checkout, we need a pluggable aggregation strategy that Hiram mentioned. We need some logic to check out multiple bags, right? And you cannot really make the assumption that if you checked in a number of bags, that's what you're going to get back in the general sense. And then we have multiple source channels for bags. I would like to have that too. And I would like separate message stores. A message store is a concept that's missing in CAML 2. We are talking about it in CAML 3, and I hope this presentation is going to show why it's needed. And then we need an exit for destination after the aggregation was done, which is obviously an endpoint, right? And expressions are great. I'm not sure how many know my presentation at ApacheCon in Germany in November, but... Yeah, I'm going to talk about expressions a bit later. For us, expressions are the natural way of generating the correlation ID. So that's how an expression looks like. This is an expression that extracts content from the exchange. And in this case, what it does, it takes the exchange ID. Make sense? Easy? Okay. But it may not. An expression could use a whatever algorithm to evaluate the current exchange and provide a value. In this case, I don't even care about the exchange. I'm just providing a unique value. Make sense? Easy. Now, the cool thing is that expressions can be chained. And I'm not sure how many of you know that, but it's a very useful feature. So if you see a this tag expression tags another expression as a argument, and expressions are evaluated at runtime. So what this does, it prepends tag dash to whatever the other expression evaluates to, right? So if we use tag with a expression ID, what was the previous one? Exchange ID expression, it's going to look like tag dash ID dash long number there. If I use tag with simple whatever the other one was, it's going to be a tag dash one, tag dash two. So by chaining expressions, I get different behaviors, and then expressions are simple to write. It's kind of functionally, and I know that some people in this room like that. Kind of looks like Scala. So, for check-in, what I would like to see is something like this. I want from direct simple to process the claim check at check-in. I want to check in at this destination. Again, I'm using an expression there. For me, it's going to be just the constant direct check-in as an endpoint. I want to attach the tag based on the exchange ID, and then I want to keep, this is the processor I mentioned to do the separation between the body and the bags, so I want to keep just the, in the body, just the result of the, or the value of the demo header, and the time to leave is going to be 10 seconds, which my demo is going to ignore, but more realistic example should be there. And at checkout, what I want to do, it's a claim check checkout at some particular bay, because the bags come in into some bay, that carousel you have at the checkout, and you have many larger airports, right? And then I want to aggregate using some sort of aggregation strategy. My aggregation strategy, what it's going to do is it's going to take the baggage, which is a string, and do a two-upper on it just to see some action. And then it's going to check if that's all we're waiting for. Are there many more baggages that we're waiting for? We're going to see in a second why that's useful. And then we're going to proceed to exit. So the CAMEL DSL, as an aside, is not easily and nicely extensible, because the way it is, there are some historical reasons.
What do you say the CAMEL what is not extensible?
DSL, which stands for? Yay. So we wanted to have self-completion in the ID. There were a few forces we tried to reconcile over there. And because of that, we wanted to have a dot and the ID to tell you what's possible to do over there. And that thing grew. And then when you want to add your own EIP, you have to change the core. And if you're somebody like Christian who can do that, he'll do that. But what other people gonna do? But there is a process which is a very generic EIP, if you want, that allows you to pass a processor, right? I'm not sure if you used it in your presentation. So if I use that, I can extend the CAMEL DSL with mini, micro, nano DSLs, if you want, like this one, right? What I'm going to have to do is my DSL is going to have to return a processor, yes. So, and similarly at arrival, I have that claim check dot arrival. This, we're going to talk about it a little bit, and then unload from some, is the other end of the processing channel for the bags, right? So I'm going to wait for the bags to come on the SIDA arrival, and as they come, I'm going to put them in the Portland Bay. Make sense? Now, this code you're going to see is used in the route builder. So how come I can do this thing, check arrival, and do something reasonable in the route builder configure method? Question for those who are intermediate to advanced. Because somewhere in that DSL, I'm gonna call from, and that's on that this. That's why I'm passing this. So basically, this DSL is creating another hidden route, if you want. Okay? It looks neat. It's a bit tricky. The technique is used in CAMEL BAM, which is another component. I'm not sure if you're aware of it, but that's how you can have your own DSL. So I wanted to point that out too. Another thing I wanted to mention is that the first mention I'm aware of, if I recall correctly, in the CAMEL, on the CAMEL mailing list, was a few years ago when the basement coders did some interview around CAMEL, and then they started to talk, Craig Tetterin, about the way they process their videos. And they said, our videos are big, and we want to process them in chunks and do all sorts of things. So the claim check doesn't really help you there, because actually you have a lot of processing going on for the large payloads, okay? So how is that all implemented? You have to wait for the demo, and then you have to ask questions, right? And later on, if you want, you can check out the code on GitHub. It's already there. So back to business processes. We're almost done with the slides. It's the same principle as the claim check, right? Because I'm not really checking in bags, but I'm doing something with messages. I have to reconcile things at some point. So it's mostly the checkout, the claim check checkout we're going to use to correlate messages. Okay? But we need a persistent store to store the messages in their intermediate state. And CAMEL doesn't do that. However, CAMEL gives us a lot of options for persistence that I think Kai mentioned this morning, right? SQL or NoSQL, file systems, HDFS, you name it. And again, expressions are our friend. So the demo is going to be about the fictitious travel reservations company. Let's call it Expedium. No relation to any friendly sponsor. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to use XML in this case. I'm going to send this kind of reservation request with an ID, a name, the origin, a destination, and then I'm going to request what exactly do I want, right? And then we're going to make requests for every request I have. I have a request for airline and hotel, right? Intuitively. I'm going to create one request for each. That's going to be like just the ID and the name, and the reply is going to be the hotel and the value. And then when I get all the messages, the replies back for what I was requesting, then the result is going to look like this. I'm going to have extra elements in XML for the result of the airline and the hotel. And that's it with the slides, with the dry slides. How am I doing with the time? Do I have some time? Oh, perfect, perfect. So we can get rid of this thing. Go to the fun stuff. And I can't see very well from this angle. So I'm going to be a bit slow. Is it this one? I'm going to run it from Eclipse. It's a unit test. We clean up some directories there. I'm going to jump over this and go straight to the route and see how we can read routes. Okay. So I'm going to send a message to Direct Simple. You've seen the code already, so you should understand what it does. I'm going to send the message at the check-in endpoint, which is this one. At the check-in endpoint, so the message is going to contain a POJO, right? POJO that has all those fields. I'm going to set the header, and I'm going to put it in a file, right? That's what I'm doing at check-in. Then I'm going to send, we expect the message to just contain the value of the header demo on the main path, and then I'm going to send it to a CDA queue, and this is not really necessary anymore, but I'm going to set a header for the file name, and I'm going to, so the name of the file is going to be the value of the claim check tag header, the one we generated with this expression. It's just to see the content of the file name. So what happens after this is not really relevant for the claim check part. And then, because this is where the messages go, you'll see the value, I mean, the importance of the delay. I'm gonna check out from the Bay Portland, and I'm gonna aggregate using this sort of aggregation strategy. No need to check because there's only one baggage in this thing, and then I'm gonna go to the exit where I'm gonna log and all that. Now, here, because we send files, I'm gonna convert the body to a string, and I'm gonna set the property to, of the, remember, I'm putting this in files, and the name of the file contains the claim check tag. I think it's fairly obvious that I have to propagate the tag somehow, right? When I travel, the tag stays in my pocket. Otherwise, I can't retrieve my bags. So we make the convention in this demo that the claim check is going to be propagated as the file name. So what I have to do here when I receive them, I'm going to have to take the file name and set it as the claim check tag property to do the correlation. And at arrival, as I said, I'm going to take whatever comes on CDA arrival. You see that it comes from files, it goes to CDA arrival as well, and that's pretty much it. This is a test route that I'm using in this unit test. So because I'm using files and because these are long-running transactions, somebody has to do the processing. And the processing in our case is actually moving a file. And I have a route that does that, but it's not started automatically because then we wouldn't see the long-running process part. So that's why that route is started here after 2 seconds. So you're gonna see how the message is waiting, then after 2 seconds the file is copied, and then the correlation happens, and then the message gets processed, okay? Questions? Fairly clear how it should work? Let's see how it works. So we wait 2 seconds, then something happens and it's done. So we have this claim check, the check-in processor, and then we have the we process the message with this tag, and you saw the tag dash and the exchange ID. And then, let me see at the time, after 2 seconds, something, we have on arrival the checkout process. Well, the checkout processor receives messages on both pipelines, right? Is it obvious? Because the checkout processor has to do the correlation. Okay, let me, what's the issue with the way things happen in the airport, right? So baggages come on the carousel, right? The way they come in Camel, one by one. They are consumed one by one. But what happens with the people? How can people can take their baggages? They have the tag, but how are they lined up? Basically, they are all conscious people sitting there, right? This is a pool of threads really waiting. Each thread waits for its own bag, and that doesn't scale, right? So we have to do something about it, right? So what we do actually, a better analogy what how this is working is people come in with their tags and then they go in the message store waiting for another event to happen, right? And then you have to keep an index in memory, although your messages are in the data store, you have to keep an index in memory of what people are waiting for their baggages. Because one of them is gonna be there first, and you have to understand or know the way your business process works, what the patterns are. Who's gonna come first? The processing on the main pipeline or the bags pipeline? So what's more likely to expect at the destination? What indexes are larger? So all these kind, I don't have time unfortunately to go into the details, but that's the idea. So one comes first and cannot be really resolved because the other part is not there. So that has to wait. And that you have to put in storage because it cannot really wait there in front of the carousel because it's gonna be a big bunch of people, right? So you send them away, but you keep an index or maybe you keep their tag or whatever saying, okay, this guy's already here, he's waiting for his bag, but the bag is not yet here. So then you have another event coming, the bag itself. And at that time you have to see, okay, so the bag came, this is the tag ID. Is the tag ID in the index already? Is the person waiting for it here or not? If he is, then you have to extract it from the store, marry them together and let them go, and you're done. Now, if the bag arrives first, then you have to put the bag in the message store and keep an index of that, and when the person comes, says, okay, yours is not coming on the carousel, actually don't wait on the consumer for the bag to arrive because it's already there somewhere else. So, is it clear why, this is one of the reasons with the message store, and it's not the only one, but is it clear how a message store would be helpful and why we need that? And in our case, the state of the process are really exchanges that are not fully processed. So, in our case, what comes first? The messages in the queue, right? Because they are processed right away. Actually, there is a 10 seconds delay. Sorry, a 2 seconds delay, which is somewhere here, because that's when we move the file. But look what I'm gonna happen. I'm gonna add some crazy processing on the bag pipeline. Okay, this is gonna be 5 seconds. The other one is 2 seconds. So what came here first? The regular queue, right? Now if I run it again, now you have to wait 5 seconds actually. Arrivals is first, and the queue is second. So in one case, depending on the characteristics of my process, one is gonna come first. Obviously I'm gonna have different things in the index in one case and another, but nevertheless, the correlation happens. It may be a bit complicated, but the code is available. Feel free to take a look at it. Any questions? I need some activity because...
So with the message store, are you talking about persisting the exchange or persisting, you know, the whole exchange or persisting bits and pieces of data that you can rekindle an exchange or start an exchange?
Very interesting question. So what's the answer? You tell me. Speculate. So what's the message store? What message store am I using here? Actually, for this thing, I'm using this. Because I have, let's say I have to bring 5 bags, right? And they come at 10 minutes apart each, right? So I'm there in the message store. I already gave my tag, right? And the first bag comes, right? So what should happen then? The dispatcher, whatever guy over there, takes me from storage, says, okay, here's your bag, here's bye-bye. And that's why I have that a predicate over there that the value was null in this case, but I'm gonna show an example when it's not null, where I have to see, am I waiting for more? Because if that's the case, I keep the tag and I go back to storage. We're waiting for the next one. The next one comes, takes me back from storage, right? But if the bag comes first, so there is, why is it relevant? Because we do that aggregation of exchanges. Somebody here asked about aggregation earlier this morning. We have to do the aggregation of exchanges, but the aggregation, you have to separate the message store for the main flow from the message store from the bags flow. Because the aggregation you do on the main flow, if the bag came without the person, then you don't aggregate anything. It's not like one message store and you aggregate any two. If two messages, if two bags come, you cannot really aggregate them. And when I come, give me 2 bags. I'm not sure, that's a very important part. I'm used to the domain, and I'm not sure if you can follow. It's not really easy, but if you think about it, it is. It's just not enough time. Okay? So, bottom line, there are 2 message stores. It's one for the one where the things are aggregated, the person in our case, and the one, other one for the messages that are coming and cannot be aggregated, so they have to stay in store, all of them. Okay? So, what's the message store? In my case, it should be somewhere here. It's a memory message store, and it's basically this. It's a map of a string, which is our tag, to an exchange. Okay? Now, it could be just a message. There are different ways of doing it. I prefer this one because it was a bit easier for me for some reason that I'm not gonna go into. But, what's the problem with the memory message store? Doesn't scale. Yeah, you didn't really solve much, did you, right? But maybe for the mid time, the mid running processes. So this is the claim check demo. Any questions?
Is this code available on GitHub or something?
Yes, it is. And on the slides, it's going to be recorded, but it's on my, I'm going to show you again at the end the URL. Yes, they are, and the presentation, the slides are too. And they are under an Apache license, I guess, so feel free to use them. present to others, spread the word. So this is it. I have the other another demo for the long running process, which is somewhere here, which uses a file message store. Okay, so now we're in business. So I'm gonna show you quickly how the route builder looks like. How am I doing on time? 10 minutes? 20 minutes. Ah, we have plenty of time. So this is a bit more complicated as a route. Okay, the message store. I kind of made the point of using the crudest possible tools Camel makes available, and Christian would laugh at me, and he wouldn't put that, even put this kind of stuff in his optimization slides. We have obviously better options for persistence and serialization, like any takers. The obvious is JMS, right? Put them in a persistent queue and you're done with it. But I used files. So you can do it. So what's the answer if somebody says that there's something you cannot do with Camel? You should laugh. So I'm using XML in this case. I showed you how the messages look like. And here I have, this is the reservation route, and I do a non-Marshall using JXB because I get XML, right? I have some objects there. You can guess how they look like. And then I do a process. I generate the requests, which means that I'm processing that field with the requests where I have airline, comma, hotel, comma, could be car, a combination of any, because you don't really exactly know what the guy. I wanted to show that you can have multiple number of bags coming in, right? And the only way you would know how many is by splitting that string by comma and see how many requests you were working, requesting. And here, after that, I'm gonna send to a recipient list to that property request recipients, which is obviously generated before, and tokenize on the comma. Is it fairly clear how it works? Who understands this part? Raise of hands. Oh my God, I'm doing a terrible job.
I can't see it. And these guys are a lot younger when the eyes are gone. So. That's why I asked about the GitHub and the code.
Okay. Sorry about that. So basically we use a recipient list because it's a very fun, underused EIP in Camel. And then that means that for a message that will contain airline and hotel, we're gonna send two requests, and the requests are gonna go to, I make a convention. If you put airline comma hotel, I'm gonna send to CDA colon airline, CDA colon hotel. So I'm generating the endpoints from those values using a very crude algorithm. Sorry? Yes. Speaking of which, Camel uses heavily convention over configuration. That's a neat thing to keep in mind. But this process check-in reservation, what does it use? A processor, right? See what I'm using underneath? Because it's kind of ugly to show a claim check sort of pattern in a business process stuff. But you can hide a lot of things behind methods and stuff like that. You also make the routes smaller, easier to read, clearer, right? And then these are the things that are gonna get the requests, and I got this. So CDA Airline, CDA Hotel, and CDA Car, what they do, they kind of simulate the external systems I need to hit to make the reservations of the independent resources, like car, hotel, airline. Makes sense? And those use a two-way asynchronous sort of model. And if you see what I'm doing, I'm just logging. But in real life, you would send an email, right? The reply is not going to come back. It's not a request reply. The reply is not going to come back on the same channel, maybe not even on the same protocol. So in this case, it's enough to log or tell somebody that you need to make that reservation for this ID, and the response should come on the other channel at some point.
And the stages
of the CEDA? No, I'm not talking about the stages of the CEDA, no. I'm talking about how I modeled this business process, the conventions I made. And I'm talking about the fact that I'm emulating that. Read this as I'm sending an email or I'm making some asynchronous request to that system to tell me what airline I can use, right? And at some point, I expect an XML file to come back via this channel, basically a file to be placed here. Make sense? So keep it, as you can see, although I'm sending requests to different systems, the responses are going to come in the same place. But I can make other choices. It doesn't really matter, right? And here, I'm going to unmarshal again using JXB, and I'm going to send all the replies in the same place to be processed. And then I have to set the property for the claim check tag header that has to be propagated somehow. But in this case, I'm using another what? To extract it. An expression, right? And the expression is if it's a reservation, I get the ID from the reservation. If it's a request, I get the ID from the request, right? Where were we before? So after they come, then I handle the reply. So what's this thing? I'm hiding the claim check thing, which actually what it does here, it does from the builder that we passed, it does the from URI process bay. And then I'm now. So I'm creating that hidden route I was mentioning before. In the configure method, you don't have to say from all that kind of stuff over there. You can just put a method that generates that code. It's the same thing, right?
Okay. You're achieving a hidden route.
What matters is that the from method is called inside the configure thing, which is going to create actually. The camel routes are built in two steps. And we have that model for the DSL in the core, which shouldn't be there.
It's like putting something inside your init method.
No, that's building an AST.
As an example.
Okay.
You're building a route that's hidden because you're building it in the configure.
No, I'm building it via a mechanism that abstracts a lot of complexity. That's what I want to do. I want to hide complexity. I want to make things simple. And that's what one of the ideas in CAMEL, to make integration simple. Okay. Okay, let's go back where we were. And so basically this handle thing does nothing else but create another route at the end of the day in there. And that route is going to generate the AST, and then from that AST, we're going to have the route. So if you look with JMX, you did there, like you put there some two routes, and you look with JMX and see there are 10. Well, maybe because there is some code over there that creates them on the fly, and as I said, CamelBAM does that, and that could be good and bad if it generates surprises, but anyway. So any questions? No, I'm going to run it now, and I'm going to run it using, let me see, okay, nothing. So I'm going to use CAMEL run, right, because I want this to run kind of like forever, right? So the thing is almost ready. It's ready now. And what it does, all those routes are use files under target expedium. And we see that there is nothing, right? So what I did, I prepared some sample files. And I'm going to do it. They are in SRC, test, resources, samples. Let's start with this. So this is Christian, who's flying in from Frankfurt. And there is a reservation number 102. Can you see anything? Barely. Okay, so what it says is an ID, then there is a name, Christian's name, origin is Frankfurt, destination is here, and he requests a airline, hotel, and car. I said I'm using the crudest tools. I'm using VI. I hope that doesn't offend you. And there is another one for Hadrian. And Hadrian only requests that last line, airline and hotel, because he's not driving for some reason, okay? So what I'm gonna do, I am gonna send a request, which is basically, in our case, just copying a file. So I'm gonna copy this to target reservations, right? We see that something happens, and let's look on the disk. And I chose this method with the files for us to have time to look on the disk, see what happens and all that, right? So if I do a, I think I have this done before. My angle is not very good, I'm sorry. So what do we see? I don't have a pointer. Do you see that the reservations.camelhadrian.xml? It's too small? Let's try that. Oh, it's right here. It's right here. It says .camel. That means that this thing was processed and it went in this store under this ID, right? And if we look at the content of this file, it's going to be exactly the file that we sent. Because we don't need to, so we're not, for business processes, we don't really use the claim check to unload the big bag to be able to process our message in a very lean way. What we're doing actually, we don't care the size of the message, we only care about the fact that we can check out and aggregate messages that are processed independently. So I have another sample for the airline request, which contains the same ID. Oh, I really feel bad about the size. It's the same ID, the same name. And this is the reply we're sending. So for the type is airline, and here we say Delta. So the system says that we're gonna send Hadrian with Delta. So if we copy this, to replies, because that's where all the replies go, if you remember. We see that some more stuff happens. But if you look here, you'll see that the message is still in the store. It's in the store main because it's waiting for more. In our case, it's waiting for the hotel reservation, right? And we see that the reply was already processed. We see that it moved it in the .camel directly, which is the default behavior for the file component, but you can change that with a file move strategy and stuff like that, right? So, because we're running out of time, I'm gonna copy the other thing, the hotel thing. And we see that this is completed. All open requests are satisfied now, and he's completing the reservation. And if we look at the content of the thing, there's nothing in the message store anymore. Okay, but now it ended up in the completed directory as hadrian.xml. And if we look at it, Expedium completed, I think, hadrian.xml. Now it has the extra things here, the Delta for the airline and the Hilton for the hotel. Makes any sense? And if we do the same for Christian, if we copy reservation, oops. The same thing happened, and if I copy dash airline to reply, and the same thing, but the hotel to reply. I did the same thing I did for myself. Is it gonna work? No, it's not, right? Why? Still waiting, still waiting, still 2 minutes. Why? Because it was an extra request for a car, right? So now the system can go down. That's why we use the file persistence store. And that's the funny part, because this is a long-running transaction that we know takes between hours and years. We have to wait for the reply to come. You're stuck with me for a long time here. Now, so now if the car comes, the same, all open requests are satisfied. I didn't show you, but it's probably obvious that I can send both Adrian and Christian at the same time, and both are gonna wait in the store. We don't have to send them one after the other. So, that's what happened. These are the replies that are processed, nothing in the store, and 2 incomplete. So, that was the presentation. Any questions?
GitHub.
GitHub, I don't know.
GitHub.
It's somewhere here. In the first slide, no. I know it is, because I moved it from the Q&A.
Just back a couple of minutes.
Oh, I'm sorry. No.
Pay attention to details, Glenn. So, yes.
So what's a typical strategy to actually account for replies that are never received? As in, how do you clean up the store for data that's just going to sit there
forever? Well, the claim check processor does that for you. I implemented it. Mm-hmm. Basically, what it's going to do is going to call on the aggregation strategy. You have to provide your own aggregation strategy. CAML doesn't help you. There is nothing in CAML, a default aggregation. Actually, there are a few, but I'm not sure if those are going to help you in this case, right? So you write your aggregation strategy that says, this is the main flow, this is the back flow. If the main exchange receives one, how do I give the bag to the guy, okay? And you do that, and then the guy has the bag, and you're done. But the next step is to figure out, okay, is this exchange complete? Am I done?
Yeah,
I and you have a predicate for...
What if it never completes? How do you clean up your message store with orphan data?
If you remember...
You have to put a process in... You have the time to leave, same thing, right? You have to put a process in place for that. Cron jobs, I don't know. Any other questions?
So basically it's a process engine with state persistent using CAML?
Yeah.
Could you implement something like BPMN over it?
I'm laughing now. Yes, well, that's a longer answer. Actually, we should talk about Camel 3.0. By the way, who is contributing to Camel now, besides the committers I know?
How many committers?
Yeah, committers, hands up for everybody to give you beers and stuff when they see you, Summer. No?
Yeah.
Dan just left. Hiram was there. He left. Okay, so anybody interested in contributing to Camel? Oh, good job. So feel free to ask questions. We're a very friendly bunch in general. Busy bunch, but friendly bunch. So feel free. No more questions? No? Okay. Well, but wait, there's more. So I'm trying to figure out who was the most caffeinated guy today. Well, right now would be Dan. Because I have a, I need some help. I have a server here. Who knows what this is? Two, three people. And I would like very soon to see the resource hungry camel running on this thing. This is a Raspberry Pi. So it's my surprise to one of you. I'm not sure how to choose, so.
It's like an Arduino.
So it's kind of like an Arduino run setup. So anybody interested in helping putting Camel on this thing? No other takers.
Thank you.
Good, thank you so much. That was fun.